I dreamt about being a world champion. That was my lifelong goal as an amateur boxer and a professional boxer. I started when I was 7 years old. I believe when I was 7 or 8, I fought the middleweight champion's son, Gene Fulmer. I fought his son, which is Bart Fulmer. And we fought over here at the Williams Gym at New Mexico State University. But I didn't really take it serious until I was probably about 14, 15 years old. I became professional, and I started, the money I was making, I was supplementing my education in college. And it got to the point that I started becoming so successful in boxing, I had to put my education on hold.
I want to go back to school. I didn't go to school this semester. I have been. I think that's important for me.
For MSU?
Yeah.
What are you studying?
Business.
But that's really what got me into turning pro, was that I needed some money to pay my tuition. My big break was when I fought Freddie Roach for the ESPN Championship.
We both fought so hard, and we're just head-to-head. We banged heads sometimes, and both of us were a little bit rough, little elbows, little heads. But you know, it was a fight. So, and it was the referee let us fight.
For the winner and new ESPN Junior Light Champion, Louis Burke.
Louis Burke wins a unanimous decision and grabs
it. Escalated me. You know, it escalated my career. Everybody noticed me then, and they kept replaying it on TV. And so I got a lot of exposure for that. I never did win a national championship, but I was ranked, I think, as high as 3 in the amateurs. I had an offer to go train fighters professionally, so I took up that offer and went to Houston and was training fighters for Ron Weathers, who at that time was managing, promoting George Foreman. And then I called a buddy of mine that was involved in Tough Man contests out of Detroit. I said, hey, let's start a promotion company and start doing all kinds of promotions. So he came into town, and for a year, and we were doing pretty good. We were putting on boxing shows regularly in El Paso, the small club fights. We had the Miss Hawaiian Tropic franchise, you know, and we were doing that, and concerts. We were doing all kinds of stuff, and it was great. It was a lot of fun. And there's not a whole lot of things in this world that I know anything about, but I know a lot about boxing.
When I was about 8 years old, 8 or 9, my father took me down to Juarez, Mexico, for some fights that were going to be happening at the bullring. One of the fighters involved was an ex-amateur that my dad used to train, by the name of Earl Large. And he was fighting that former world champion, Chuchu Castillo. And we went to the fights in Juarez, and it was your typical rowdy, crazy crowd. Probably even more rowdy back then than it is now, believe it or not. You know, there was a lot going on, and they were all pretty exciting. And by the time the fight ended, most of the people thought that Earl Arch had won. But being that Chuchu was from Mexico and former world champion, of course, the judges favored him, and he got the decision, even though it was very unpopular. Soon after, a mini riot ensued because of the bad decision. Saw beer bottles and cups of beer, and they sold these old pillows that you could sit on because it was a bull ring. So you wouldn't have to sit on the cement stadium stands. And And they started flinging those like flying saucers down to the ringside rows. It was pretty dangerous, especially for an 8-9-year-old kid.
I started training kids when I was a kid.
Straight punches, keep your chin down and throw straight punches at this guy, okay?
My father always told me that if you want to become a better fighter, you get a kid and you train him from scratch.
Louis is the best. He's the best trainer around. I work with very good trainers out in Houston. I've been a lot of places, and Louis, we go together really well. You know, he's like a big brother to me. You know what I mean? He's always been there for me, no matter if it's boxing or not, you know? But besides that, he's taken me pretty much from scratch.
David gave me a call, and shortly afterwards, David started coming up, and Rocky and I were both training David at that time.
What's this? You're pulling straight back. I want you to get down in here with your hands up. I want you to break down, okay? Take a swig.
I see a lot of me and him in the style, and I see a lot of, I don't want him to make the same mistakes that I made.
I want you to keep that hand in position. That's it. Keep that one up. Up.
It's really a brutal business.
You know, he talks to me every day. We talk every day about stuff like that. And he's kind of like my, I guess you'd say, like my custom model. I look for him for advice over anybody.
Off the jab. Everything off the jab. Keep the jab working.
Pick him up.
And throw an overhead right. I don't know how. Nice, David. Nice. Keep working that. Come on, keep working it.
Referee stops about under the direction of the doctor due to a broken nose suffered by the red corner. El ganador, por roca técnico, your winner by TKO, David El Niño Rodriguez.
You have to know who you can trust and who you can't in the sport. And I think that's where I would have a leg up on everybody. Involved in boxing, he was an amateur coach, and he was my first coach in the pros. Also, he trained two or three professionals on top of hundreds of amateurs. During the time I was getting ready to fight for the ESPN Championship against Freddie Roach, we were at a pre-fight interview, and somebody asked my father, "When did you know Louis going to become a boxer?" And his answer was 6 months before he was born. So, I mean, that kind of tells you my involvement and when I first started. I was born into the sport.
The Burke family stands for sort of what Las Cruces is all about. And it represents cultures coming together.
When I saw Louis for the first time, I saw this little angel with he was bald-headed, but you could tell his hair was very light, probably blonde. And when he opened his eyes, they were blue-gray. And his little face and his arms and legs, which were all, I thought, perfect. The first time that Sammy said, oh, he's going to be a boxer, was probably when Louis was hungry and he was moving his little arms around, you know, screaming, I want a bottle or whatever. And I think that's probably the first time Sammy thought, aha, you know, we have a little boxer in the family.
Mom held him up in the window. The first thing he did when he got home, it appeared like he was doing push-ups. So right then we knew he was going to be a champion.
Louis missed his partying days when he was a teenager and in his early 20s because he was training for boxing, and he was very disciplined. No staying out late. He had curfew. He would get up at the crack of dawn in the morning to run, to train. He couldn't drink. You know, he had to watch his diet. It's very difficult for a young man, and that's the prime of his life. You know, when all his friends are out partying and going places, and he has to stay home and train, you know, work out, watch his diet.
My father didn't show a lot of affection or love to his kids, except after a fight, you know, whether we won or lost, you know. And if we lost, he was very compassionate. If we won, you could see how proud he was.
His father and I were very close, and I helped Louis for a couple of fights, and I had a lot of fun with Louis. I was really excited about it, and I wish I could have continued through his whole career. I think I could have helped, and I think we did help each other.
You know, he was my pride and joy. He's still my pride and joy.
Our family is very, very tight, and we might not see each other for a while. Like, my sister lives in Seattle.
He looked after me a lot and was very protective throughout school because we were 2 years apart. He was always looking out after me and very protective. And
Louis was trying very hard to lose weight. He needed to make his weight, and he was having trouble doing that.
I remember one time after he was defeated in a fight and he was knocked out, and he wound up in the emergency room in the hospital. And I remember going to visit him, and I remember telling him, Louis, you know, that must have been some party you went to, because I gave him the last rites. We thought he was gone.
He went into to that fight. He did make weight, but it was he had some really difficult times making his weight, which really weakened him, and ultimately he ended up with a low potassium, almost a zero potassium level. And as you know, potassium is what makes your muscles work, and your heart is a muscle. So he ran out of strength. He couldn't lift his arms. He couldn't move into the fight, and he was hoping that the fight would be over, that he could, you know, give one last hard punch and knock his opponent out, and the fight would be over. And but it didn't quite happen that way. So when they took him out of the ring, he was in bad shape.
I had blacked out prior to the ambulance coming. When they were on their way to the hospital, they had I could hear them starting to panic and working on me. The only thing was that I could see them, everything happening, but from above. From an odd angle, I could see him actually working on me. About that time, everything went like white, and I felt real comfortable. I wasn't in any pain anymore, and I really don't mind not coming back. About the time I was thinking that, I came back, and I was in intense pain, and again, and you know, I came back to reality.
I remember when Bishop Ramirez walked into his room, and. And he said, Louis, that must have been a heck of a party you were at. And Louis opened his eyes and he said, yeah, I wish you'd been there instead of me.
Even his difficult moment, His sense of humor came through, and it's been his sense of humor that has been his source of strength.
You just can't give up, you know. If you give up, then the other guy's a victor, you know, and you've given all that up, and that's how to me life is.
Congratulations on making 40, man.
To you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Louis, happy birthday to you.
I hope you guys, 1, 2, 3. All right, ready.
Do you have any plans?
Oh, when I was 20, I didn't think I'd ever get to be 40. That was an old man to me. And now, age is just a number and an attitude. Yes. I don't feel 40 years old.
See,
so there is a miracle in being 40.
Oh, yeah.
Looks 20.
He looks like 30. Yeah, 20-something.
He was a very humble man, and he helped others in his own quiet way, giving more than he could probably afford, expecting nothing back in return, except to know in his own heart that he had helped someone.
My father would have been very proud to have seen his legacy live on through building dedications and scholarship, but mostly to know that his philosophy of teaching kids respect and self-worth for themselves and others is still carried on in this building.
This building has a name now, and the Sammy Burke legacy lives on through the people that walk in these doors, and the coaches, the volunteer coaches, the volunteer workers, the fighters that come in and leave this building. My father's legacy is going to be lived on through many years through these people.
I think this is where my father really played an important role in my life, is that he always kept me grounded. You know, my father was such a good, humble guy that he always told me, says, don't get too big, you know, because there's going to be a day you're going to have to come back home, and you want to make sure people respect you for who you are and not what you did. And because if you treat them bad going up, you know, they're going to treat you bad when you're coming down.
We've always been best friends, and we always will be. We introduce each other to other people as, this is my best friend, and it'll never change. I hope it never changes. I hope that he's with me forever and I'm with him forever.
Well, Louis was just like a son. Whenever I gave him an order, he always followed. He was a very obedient type of person. Sammy raised him right, you know.
I've known Louis pretty much all my life since we've been kids. We lived in the same neighborhood and grew up together, and our families have been close all our lives, my father and his father, and you know, our grandfathers, and all up and down the valley, they've always, you know, been pretty close.
He was very respectful, but he could pull off a good one every now and then. He used to pull a good one on all of us.
He would walk around the neighborhood, walk down Melendrez Street with a snake curled around his neck, and that would scare the living daylights out of all the neighbors.
He was really into snakes and lizards. Had an alligator one time in his bathtub. I don't know what ever happened to that alligator.
The mothers of his little friends were not real happy about him bringing that alligator over to their home.
Who knows? I think his mom got rid of him. I'm a fight fan forever and ever, but I really didn't like to see Louis fighting. I he was just too close to me, but boy, I sure loved it when he won. I was so happy for him.
He's a good man to be around, Louis was.
I love the fact that firemen are looked upon as heroes. You know, kids, man, they admire us. We drive down the street in a big fire engine and kids wave at us, and that makes me feel good.
I think that you need to be very, very bold when you're doing both jobs. You need to be very aggressive. You need to analyze the situation very carefully and know what's going on. And you have to hang in there, you know, regardless of what's going on. You just have to hang in there and just keep going.
Going back to boxing is your corner. You have to trust him, and you have to have a lot of faith in your lieutenant to make sure that he's making the right decisions, and the driver operator making sure that he's taking care of his job, and the other firefighter making sure that he has your back all the time. So you do build a strong faith and a lot of trust in these guys, because sometimes your life can depend on it.
We were sitting there, Shelly was with us, and Louis started giggling, and he said, "You know, Mom, you know how you've been wanting to be a grandmother?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, you're about to be one." And he was nervous, and that's why he was giggling, because he didn't know how I was going to react, and he didn't know that Rocky had already broken the news.
It's funny how nobody ever realizes till they have kids, you know, what unconditional love is, and how somebody that really wants to take the responsibility of being a true parent will sacrifice everything.
At the time, he was working in Texas at George Foreman's training camp, training heavyweight boxers, had a fantastic future before him. And he gave that up to come home and be a full-time daddy-to-be at the time. He has had, you know, accepted full responsibility.
Yeah, it's my day off, and I usually spend my days off after my daughter gets out of school. We spend the time together. I go pick her up from school, and we go and have some ice cream, and then go try and do something. Sometimes we work on her homework, and other times we go out for bike rides, or we go to the park. And we always do something, even if it's just going out to the mall.
Samantha has completely changed his life, his lifestyle. She is his priority. He is so proud of her and everything she does. His face just beams, you know, when he talks about her. And he loves her unconditionally. He loves her probably more than anything else in the world. He's just that kind of a father.
But she's very special, and she's a bright girl. And Louis is a good father, so I think she'll do real well.
He does have sole legal rights through the court, and he takes that very seriously. On the other hand, he is a strong believer that we should be an active part of both sides of the family, and he tries very hard to have Samantha learn about her family, meet her family members, cousins, aunts, uncles, on both sides of the family, and he's very serious about that.
Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you if you're young at heart. For it's hard, you will find, to be narrow of mind if you're young at heart. You can go to extremes with impossible schemes. You can laugh when your dreams fall apart at the seams. And life gets more exciting with each passing day. And love is either in your heart or on its way. Don't you know that it's worth every treasure on earth to be young at heart? For as rich as you are, it's much better by far to be young at heart. And if you should survive to 105, look at all you'll derive out of being alive. And here is the best part, you have a head start if you are among the very young at heart.